Welcome back all of you to the online class of biology. So I started with the chapter 2, sexual reproduction in plants. And in the previous video you have studied about the structure of stamen, isn't it, anther, and the process of microsporogenesis, isn't it? So microsporogenesis means what? The development of microspores, isn't it, from where sporogenous tissues or microspore mother cells is, isn't it? So we have studied about the structure of microsporangium, isn't it? So here I told you about the epidermis. You can see the epidermis, okay, endothecium, middle layer, then what, tapetum, okay? So these are what different layers, and inside that sporogenous tissues are there, and that mature to form microspore mother cells. Each of that sporogenous tissues are able to produce what, microspores, okay, and they will undergo meiosis, isn't it? They undergo meiosis and they produce what, the microspores tetrads, okay? As after meiosis, four cells will be produced, they'll be arranged in the form of tetrad, okay? So microspore tetrads will be formed, and each microspore tetrad will disassociate and form the pollen grains. Clear? So this is what happening during the microsporogenesis, okay, where it takes place, inside the microsporangium. So microsporangium, where you can see in the anther, isn't it? In the anther you can see the microsporangium. How many microsporangium will be there in one anther? 4, isn't it? So like this microsporogenesis takes place. Now we are going to study about the pollen grain and the structure. So clearly you study first what we have studied is microsporogenesis, means formation of microspores, isn't it, or pollen grain, where it takes place, inside the microsporangium. Okay, so microsporangium, where you can see inside the anther. Understood? Now structure of microsporangium, if it is asked, you have to draw this diagram and you have to explain, okay, the different layers, sporogenous tissues, they will mature to form what, microspore mother cells. Each of them will be able to produce the microspore tetrads, and further they will disassociate, they separate from each other and form the pollen grain. Now next topic that we are going to study is the structure of pollen grain. Okay, so pollen grains are also known as what, microspores. Pollen grains, okay, are also known as the male gametophytes. Okay, so you have studied in last year that in angiosperms the gametophytic phases are very much reduced, isn't it? In gymnosperms it is little more prominent than angiosperms, and when you come to the lower forms like algae, isn't it, gametophytic phase was dominant. And when you come to the angiospermic plants, the sporophyte is more prominent and the gametophytic phase is highly reduced. And there you can see male and female gametophyte in the last year we have studied, isn't it? So the pollen grain here represents the male gametophyte. So the structure of male gametophyte or pollen grain we are going to study now. Okay, so the pollen grains are generally spherical, okay, and it is having mainly two layers. Okay, two layers are there, that is exine and intine. Okay, so the exine is the the outermost layer, outer layer, and it is made up of a substance known as sporopollenin. Okay, sporopollenin. Okay, so this is what, the substance that make up the outer layer of pollen grain, known as exine. Okay, and it is very resistant, it is the non-resistant material, and which can resist what it is actually a organic material with high resistant. Okay, and it can withstand high temperature, strong acids, alkali, then no enzymes degrades this sporopollenin. Okay, and this is the reason we get what, the pollen grains fossils. Okay, or usually we get the fossils of pollen grain because of the presence of sporopollenin. Okay, sporopollenin is what? The organic material present in the exine. Okay, exine of the pollen grain. Okay, so what is the speciality? It can be asked. Okay, it can resist high temperature, strong acids and alkali, and no enzymes will easily digest them. Okay, so due to this, how this pollen grain can germinate then? There are certain gap or pores, apertures, okay, known as germ pores. Germ pores are there which help in the germination of pollen grain. Okay, so what are germ pores? They are certain apertures, okay, or you can see certain area in the exine where there is no sporopollenin, through which only the pollen tube comes out. We have studied now pollen grain after pollination. It will be on the stigma, and in this, from the stigma it has to come down to the ovary. Okay, so this is happening through the germ pore. So what is germ pore? It is the area in the exine where there is no sporopollenin, okay, which helps in the germination of pollen grain, okay, or the coming out of pollen tube takes place through this. Okay, then next is what? The inner layer is known as the intine. Okay, intine, and you can see that it is made up of cellulose and pectin. Okay, the material which makes up the intine is what? Cellulose and pectin. Okay, and inside that you can see a cytoplasm. Okay, and this cytoplasm, okay, is surrounded by a plasma membrane, and inside the cytoplasm you can see, or inside the pollen grain you can see two different cells, the vegetative cell and the generative cell. Okay, vegetative cell is little more bigger and it is having abundant food reserve and a large irregularly shaped nucleus. Okay, and the generative cell actually floats on the cytoplasm. Okay, and it is spindle shaped and having dense cytoplasm and a nucleus. Understood? So almost in all almost 60% of the angiosperms, pollen grains are shed, okay, they are dehiced in this two celled stage. Okay, and in some other species the pollen grains are shed at the three celled stage. Okay, that is, what happens is the generative cell again mitotically divides and form two male gametes. Okay, so this is happening only in very few plants, few angiospermic plants. In most of the plants, this male gamete formation takes place after pollination, when the pollen tube germinate through the style, okay, and reaches to the ovary. So during that time this happens, but in some plants of angiosperms this happens early itself. Okay, so they will be shed at the three celled stage. Clear? Then, so you can see here, this is the vegetative cell and this is the generative cell. Generative cell give rise to the male gametes. So pollen grain as such is not the what gamete, male gamete. It is only the what male gametophyte having two cells. What are they? Vegetative cell and the generative cell. Is it clear? The characters of vegetative and generative cell I already explained. And this generative cell nucleus will give rise to the male gametes. Is it clear? So pollen grains are also economically important. Why they are economically important? Because some of them can cause a lot of diseases, like that, especially allergic diseases, okay, like chronic respiratory disorders, okay, asthma, bronchitis, etc. can be produced. Okay, so one species of plant, okay, that is parthenium or carrot grass, okay, that is imported to what our place as a weed, and that becomes the major source of or causes of pollen allergy. So that is one reason why pollen grains are important. What they can cause, what allergy. So allergy can be produced by pollen grain. Then another economic importance. So economic important, when you are saying, you have to say about the harmful effects and the if any advantage is there, that also. Okay, so they are rich in nutrients. Okay, and so it can be added in or it can be seen in various food supplements nowadays. Okay, so it is highly nutritious, and at the same time some of them can produce what allergy problems in some person. So after dehiscence, the pollen grain has to land on the stigma, then only it can survive, isn't it? It will germinate through the style and reaches to the ovary, and then fertilization occurs. And so some of them, if they are not getting any stigma, they will get damaged. So the pollen viability means how long it can retain its ability to fertilize. Okay, so this varies in different species. In some of them it will get the pollen viability will be lost very fast. Okay, so for example rice, wheat, okay, etc., the pollen grains lose their viability within 30 minutes, means after they get released from the flower they won't be able to after 30 minutes they won't be able to germinate on the stigma, or their viability will be lost. Okay, and another members like Rosaceae, Leguminale, rose plant and all, Solanaceae, potato family, Leguminaceae, etc., they can maintain the viability for months. Okay, and sometimes okay the pollen grains can be stored in liquid nitrogen at -196 degrees centigrade it can be stored for long time. If it is not having the viability, we can store them for long time for experimental purpose or for agricultural purposes, etc. We can store them at -196 degree for at liquid nitrogen. Okay, so this technique is known as the cryopreservation. Okay, so we can cryopreserve the pollen grains even though they are not having the viability for long time. So is it clear? The topic is clear. So today what we have studied is the structure of pollen grain, isn't it? Structure of pollen grain. Then we learned about the the economic importance of pollen grain. Okay, so now we will go we are going to study about the pistil. Okay, the megaspore, sporangium, the embryo sac, etc., means the female part. Till now what we have studied about the male part. The male part of the flower is what? The known as the andrecium. That whorl is known as andrecium, consisting of what? Units known as stamens. Each stamen is having what? Filament, anther, isn't it? And anther is having two lobes. In each lobe what? Thecas are there, that are separated by a longitudinal fissure. And in each theca what you can see? The microsporangium. Okay, so that is what the structure of a mature anther. Okay, and in the microsporangium structure, if you see, you can see the wall layers and the sporogenous tissue. Okay, so I have explained all that. Now the next is what? The pistil, the gynecium. Okay, the gynecium represents the female reproductive part of the flower. Okay, the gynecium representing what? The female part of the flower. So if the gynecium is having only one pistil or one carpel, then it is known as mono carpellary. Okay, if only one pistil or one carpel, okay, with ovary style and stigma, okay, one stigma, then it is monocarpellary. Or it may contain what? Many pistils, known as what? Multicarpellary. And in multicarpellary ovary itself, if all the carpels are united, then it is known as syncarpus. We have studied this in last year, isn't it? And if the carpels are not united, they are free, then it is known as apocarpus. You can see the diagram here. So this is one example of a multicarpellary, you can see many stigma, isn't it? They are joined. You cannot see them separately as units, isn't it? They are joined. That condition is known as syncarpus pistil. Okay, syncarpus. Clear? Multicarpellary and syncarpus ovary. Okay, and now you see this one. Okay, this one, you can see each of that is having different carpels and they are not united. Multicarpellary and they are apocarpus. Apocarpus ovary. Apocarpus means many carpels are there and they are not joined each other. Okay, so here you can clearly see in this diagram. Okay, that is known as what? The apocarpus ovary. Okay, and each pistil is having what? The parts like what? Stigma. So this is the carpel of a hibiscus flower. You have done this, isn't it? Ovary, style and stigma. You can see six here, isn't it? Six stigma here. So likewise, what? The carpels. Okay, carpels, the parts of the parts of a particular carpel is what? Ovary, style and stigma, isn't it? So stigma's function is what? They receives the pollen grains, isn't it? And the style that connects the stigma to the ovary, isn't it? And ovary contains what? The cavity or chambers known as locules, and inside the locules you can see what? The you can see ovules. Okay, the ovules are connected to the ovary through the placenta. Okay, so this is what the structure of a particular the carpel, isn't it? Carpels are of different types. It can be monocarpellary, multicarpellary, apocarpus, syncarpus. Okay, then each carpel is having ovary, style and stigma. Is it clear? So inside the ovary you can see what? The ovules or megasporangia. Okay, so ovules, you can relate it to the seeds of the fruits, like what? Tomato, then what? Lady's finger, etc. You see, you can see the seeds inside them, isn't it? So the seeds are actually what? Ovules or megasporangium. Okay, the number of ovules in ovary also. So the number of ovules also may vary. In some of the ovary, okay, they may have only one ovule, isn't it? Like what? Wheat or rice, etc. Yes, the number of ovules in an ovary may be one. Okay, like in paddy, rice, okay, mango, etc. You can find only one seed, isn't it? So one seed means one ovule only is present in that ovary. And in papaya, watermelon, etc., you can see many seeds, isn't it? Why there are many seeds? Because there are many ovules. So it can be the ovary can have only one ovule or it can have many ovules. Okay, so now we are going to study about the structure of megasporangium or ovule. Okay, so the ovule is attached to the ovary by a structure known as placenta. Okay, and to this placenta, the ovule is attached by a stalk. That stalk is known as the funicle. Okay, so here you can see the funicle. Okay, so through this funicle, the ovule is attached to the placenta. Okay, and then you can see the ovule, the body of the ovule fuses with the funicle in a region known as hilum. So this is the hilum region. Okay, hilum region. Okay, you can see the body of the ovule that is fusing with the funicle. Okay, and this region is known as the hilum. Okay, hilum. Then you can see covered, okay, by a protective layer. Okay, they are known as integuments. Okay, so you can see various protective layers of the ovule known as integuments, outer integument, inner integument, etc. And in a region you cannot see any integument. Okay, the part which is free of integument is known as the micropyle. Okay, the micropyle. Okay, the micropyle, this opening, okay, where the integument is not complete, is called what? The micropyle. And just opposite to the micropyle, the region what you can see is the chalasa. Okay, what is it? Chalasal region. Okay, this is the chalasa region. Okay, and then the integuments are having a mass of tissue. That mass of tissue is known as the nucellus. Okay, this tissue which is enclosed by the integument is known as the nucellus. Okay, the nucellus. So the nucellus, from the nucellus only what happened, the embryo sac or the female gametophyte is found. Okay, if a female gametophyte or embryo sac is found inside the nucellus. Okay, so once again, the structure of ovule, if you study, okay, you can see the stalk is funicle, and the funicle is attached to the body of the ovule by through a region that is known as the hilum. Okay, and they are covered by protective layers, okay, known as integuments. And the integument is free in one region, that region is known as the micropyle. The function of micropyle is, through this only the pollen tube, okay, enters into the embryo sac. Okay, the portion which is just opposite to the micropyle is known as the chalasa. Okay, the chalasa. Okay, and you can see the region, the cells that are covered by the integument. Okay, integuments, they are known as the nucellus, and in the nucellus there is what, embryo sac. Okay, embryo sac or the female gametophyte. The female gametophyte is also known as what? Embryo sac. Okay, so this is the structure of a megasporangium or ovule. Okay, so this can be asked, okay, for drawing also. The diagram can be asked, okay, and you can be asked to explain the structure of an ovule or megasporangium. Okay, so you have to learn this. Okay.